we're talking about the United States government actually honoring one of its treaties with Native Americans? Whoa, this is big news! Yep, the Supreme Court did not hold back on this one. I mean, the only reservations Gorsuch had in his opinion was the one now occupying half of Oklahoma. So now, for law enforcement purposes, that land is under the partial jurisdiction of the Creek Nation. So what the heck just happened? Well, it all started when, and this is where things get a bit uncomfortable, Native American Jim C. McGirt committed several major sex crimes against a 4-year-old girl in a part of Oklahoma that was recognized as a reservation. The state court did not go easy on him, sentencing him to 1,000 years plus life in prison, you know, in case he survived that first 1,000 years, for his violation of several federal, not state, laws. All parties acknowledged that this crime was committed, but the question was, did the state have the right to prosecute it? Now, he's argued in post-conviction proceedings that the state lacked jurisdiction to prosecute him because he is an enrolled member of the Seminole Nation of Oklahoma, and his crimes took place on the Creek Reservation. Now, before we get into the actual legal arguments about who controls exactly what land, let's answer a truly basic question. What does it matter that this man committed a major federal crime on an Indian reservation as opposed to Oklahoma proper? Well, according to the United States Criminal Code, there is a special way of dealing with crimes that occur in Indian country. Alright. Yeah, these laws came from a generation that found John Wayne movies a bit too PC. Native American reservations are not subject to state laws, but rather exclusively federal laws and tribal laws. But Stephen, I hear you saying, he violated federal laws when he committed those crimes. And yes, he did. Now this brings us back to the legal code in question, because if a Native American violates a major federal law on tribal land, he can only be tried by federal courts, not state courts. For this reason, his request was for the Supreme Court to give him a retrial of his criminal case in a federal court. If the crime was found to have been committed on Creek land, well then Oklahoma was violating Creek sovereignty by trying his crime in a state court. If, on the other hand, his crime was committed in Oklahoma proper, then everything is on the up and up. That's why the key question of this case was, did he commit his crime in Indian country? So how hard is it to know where the reservation is? Doesn't someone have a map? This should be a quick case. Well, the problem is, no one disputes that Mr. McGirt's crimes were committed on lands described as the Creek Reservation in an 1866 treaty and federal statute. But in seeking to defend the state court judgment below, Oklahoma has put aside whatever procedural defenses it might have and asked the Supreme Court to confirm that the land once given to the Creeks is no longer a reservation today. Now that's a big ask in any context. The perp is on the run and it's just crossed into the border to Mexico. This just in, the United States has annexed that part of Mexico for the purposes of making the charges stick. Now the Creek separately told the court, "Yup, that's definitely still our land and our tribesmen, so get out of here, Oklahoma." The argument itself in this case is incredibly simple. One side argued that Congress had ratified two treaties with the Creek Nation that were incredibly specific on what land the Creek Nation controlled, and then never explicitly reversed those treaties. The other side argued, sure, they never reversed those treaties, but come on, look at Congress's track record since then. Clearly, Congress doesn't care about those nations, and their intent to disregard Creek Nation's rights is pretty obvious. I mean, have you read US history? Are we really gonna have to say the quiet part aloud here? Their arguments were broken down into two pieces. First, the reservation was now so white that the reservation had been diluted into non-existence. Starting in the 1880s, Congress sought to pressure many tribes to abandon their communal lifestyles and parcel their land into smaller lots owned by individual tribe members. In 1893, Congress charged the Dawes Commission with negotiating changes to the Creek Reservation. Congress identified two goals: either persuade the Creek to cede territory to the United States, as it had before, or to agree to allot the lands to tribe members. The Greek nation responded by saying that there was no way that they were going to hand over their land to America, so congratulations, Greek tribesmen, you're now independent landowners. At this point, the indigenous members were free to do whatever they desired to do with their land. And over the next 100 or so years, quite a few of them sold their land to either natives or non-white people. I mean, Tulsa isn't exactly heralded as the regional capital of diversity, and today it's only 5% Native American, despite falling under these boundaries. So, who cares? Well, Oklahoma was arguing that this breakup of land and resale to non-tribal members constituted a de facto end of the reservation. By that logic, though, does China have sovereign control over a little bit of New Jersey? Even better, can New York start taxing South Florida? I mean, it's all us down there. Gorsuch was quick to point out that despite this breakup of land, missing on all this is a statute indicating anything like a present and total surrender of all tribal interests in the affected lands. Yeah, white people were just buying land in Creek territory, not diminishing the sovereignty of the governing Creek nation. Now, to really drive this point home, Gorsuch wrote, "This court has explained repeatedly that Congress does not disestablish a reservation simply by allowing the transfer of individual plots, whether to Native Americans or others." Gotta tell you, he sounds a little bit exasperated there. How many times do we have to keep declaring this? Stop using it as an argument! Now, for the other argument of congressional intent, Justice Roberts listed in his dissenting opinion a bunch of congressional acts explicitly passed with the intent of undermining this treaty. Wow, that is a long quote I'm about to read. But hey, no one can accuse Congress of cutting corners when it comes to disenfranchising Native Americans. Congress began by establishing a uniform body of law applicable to all occupants of the territory, regardless of race. To apply those laws, Congress established the United States Courts for the Indian Territory. Next, Congress systemically dismantled the tribal governments. It abolished tribal courts, hollowed out tribal lawmaking power, and stripped tribal taxing authority. Congress also eliminated the foundation of tribal sovereignty, extinguishing the Creek Nation's title to the lands. Finally, Congress made the tribes members of citizens of the United States and incorporated them into the drafting and ratification of the Constitution for their new state, Oklahoma. While that might read like Uncle Sam in a confessional, it was all meant to establish that, yeah, Congress systemically sought to destroy this reservation. So recognizing this land as a reservation would undermine the will of Congress regarding the implementation of this treaty. Unfortunately for him, Gorsuch found that, while the laws represented serious blows to the Creek, they just as plainly left the tribe with significant sovereign functions over the lands in question. He acknowledged that Congress 100% has the authority to break this treaty and eliminate the reservation on a whim, but they just haven't done that yet. For the court to eliminate a reservation on the implied intentions of Congress, when they hadn't chosen to expressly do it themselves, that would, in his opinion, go against the word of the law. Because of this, the Supreme Court ruled that the Native American in question is able to have a new trial in federal court. Similarly, they expanded the sovereignty of the Creek Nation to reaffirm the largest reservation in the United States. This is not to say that now Eastern Oklahoma is under Creek law, everybody panic and share this with 10 of your friends. But it does say that Native Americans in Eastern Oklahoma are under exclusively Creek law and federal law, cannot be investigated in the reservation by state or local law enforcement without tribal consent, and need to be tried in either a tribal court or the federal court. It also brings into question hundreds of state convictions of Native Americans that might now need a retrial in federal courts. So there you have it. Gorsuch sided with the liberal justices to bring us this majority opinion that, while Congress has explicitly tried to eat away at the sovereignty of the Creek Nation, they haven't yet said the quiet part loud, so the actionable part of this treaty still stands. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. First, I'd like to thank my patrons for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the courts, join this growing list of exceptional individuals by clicking on that link in the description. Also remember to subscribe and ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring. Give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw, and lastly, as always, thank you for watching.